ओम ज्ञान तमरांदश ज्ञानांजना शलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। श्री चैतन्य मनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूप पदा कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदांतिकं। वंदेहं श्रीगुरुं श्रीयुत पदकमलं श्रीगुरुं वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सगना रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजना सहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधा कृष्णपादान् सगना ललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च। हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधु दीनबंधो जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिका कांत राधा कांत नमोस्तुते। तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानो सुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये। वांछा कल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्ण। सो वी आर देयर इन द लास्ट लेग ऑफ द इंट्रोडक्शन टू भगवद गीता। वी सॉ अबाउट इन द यस्टरडे सेशन, इट वॉज अ वेरी नाइस। ओके, सो if there is any question is there, we can put it down now. We can handle the questions and proceed further. So by then, if anybody is wanting to ask questions, you can put. By then, I'll just give a little summary of what we did yesterday. You know, we saw that how this Sanatana world, or how to enter into this Sanatana world. So we had a little description about the Sanatana world. So that is the it is natat bhasayate shuryo na sashanko na bhavakah. It doesn't require the illumination like sun, moon, fire or electricity and things like that. That is a very self-illuminating kind of place. And many, many more features are there like that. So Bhagavad Gita just gives a hint of what to expect in the spiritual world and how will we get to that world. So then we saw about yam yam vapi smaran bhavam and then ante narayana smriti and things like that. So if we remember the Lord at the point of death, so we will attain that nature. And then if we remember yam yam vapi smaran bhavam tajatante kalevaram, so if we remember different like anything of this material world or something like that, so then we will remain here. Then we also saw that yanti deva vrata devan pitrunyanti pritruvata bhuteja yanti bhut like bhutani, like that. No, we saw that yanti mad yachino pimam. So like if we worship different kind of demigods, then we will reach them. If we worship the Supreme Lord, then we will reach to the Supreme Lord. So all those things we saw. And then finally it came to the point of whatever we remember at the point of death, no, that's what we will be transferred to. And all that we do in the throughout the life, so it is like it actually amounts to the point of remembrance of what we remember in the final moment, right? So that's how it is. And then we saw about the aspect of how to actually transfer our consciousness to spiritual consciousness. So we are having so many different materials to read, newspapers or articles and things like that. And in the modern days, it's like more of social media, YouTube, Netflix and stuff like that. So this is where we are feeding our material input. So if we can feed spiritual input into the system, so by the way of reading the scriptures, spending time with chanting the names of the Lord and reading the scriptures, anyways, we are going to do this thing, materially or spiritually, we are going to do this recreation. We are going to hover our consciousness on something, except for the essential aspect of life, that is, you have to cook, for your eating, and then you have to take care of, various basic necessities. And apart from that, so many other things we do. If we actually question ourselves, why are we doing all those things? it is just that, you know, we are doing it and nobody knows why we are doing it. So just whiling away, and so much of recreation is there built around in the society. We are doing all of them. So why we actually have to do that? And we say like, no, this is how everybody are. And no, we are just doing, we are just following. So we have to replace that thing with Krishna consciousness. And we have to replace the consciousness with which we are doing our regular activities also. So when we are cooking, so we have to cook for the pleasure of the Lord, thinking that the Lord will enjoy this preparation. And when we are doing our work or whatever we are doing, so we should maintain our Krishna consciousness. So that is a way of, that is a way we can actually transfer our consciousness from material to spiritual. And if we do this thing, then at the point of death, definitely we will remember. So in the difficult situation, what we will remember, that thing which we love the most, that thing we like the most, that is the thing we will remember. And if we love and like the Lord the best, if we love Krishna so much, so then automatically we will remember him. And how to actually develop attraction for a person? So one time, one of the devotees were asking that how to develop nice kartal. One devotee was playing very nice kartal. So the other devotee asked like, how are you playing this kartal so nicely? So then he told, see, kartal is a manifestation of Balaram. And if you spend time with kartal, then you will understand kartal. So it is just that you need to spend time with that entity. So if we want to love Krishna, then we just need to spend time with Krishna. So how will we spend time with Krishna? By chanting, by reading about him, from Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam, and by discussing about the Supreme Lord with devotees. So we become attracted to the Lord, and we become a lover of the Lord. And if we love the Lord really, so then at the point of death, who else we will think about? So we will think about our most loved object, that is the Supreme Lord. So that's how we can actually transfer our consciousness. And we'll see how is it possible. That is today's session. Yes, Pooja Mataji, you can unmute and ask. You can, after the questions, we will start the session.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. My questions are from the Monday session, which is paragraph 31 to 44. In paragraph 31, prior to paragraph 31, we understood what Sanatana Dharma is. So Sanatana Dharma, or the sky, the Sanatana Supreme Personality, and the Sanatana living entities are qualitatively one. So is there a single word which we use for all these three, or it's the Sanatana Dharma which is, considered, which comprises of all these three things?
Sarvam Kala Vidam Brahma. Brahman is the one word for everything.
Brahman. So the Sanatana Dharma, or the sky and the Supreme Personality and living entities, it's Brahman only.
Sarvam Kala Vidam Brahma. That means this is a Vedanta Sutra, which is kind of a Vedanta Sutras are, sutras means it's like kind of very, very abstract, very condensed, formulas. And it says everything that exists is Brahman, right? So technically speaking, the Supreme Lord is the Parabrahman. So Arjuna explains that in glorifying the Lord, Param Brahma, Param Dhamma, Pavitram, Paramam Bhavan. And then the living entities are called as Jiva Brahman, and the material nature is called Mahat Brahman, and the spiritual world is also Brahman. Say anything, the Lord means Brahman. And the energies of Lord are non-different from the Lord. So they are also Brahman. So there is nothing else apart from Brahman that exists in the entire creation.
Okay. And yes. And in paragraph 32, there is this line which says that the combined association of the Supreme Lord and the Jiva in the Supreme Abode is the perfection of human life. So this basically means that how we are here in this material world, we are similar looking in the spiritual world also. And this form and the Lord form, when we coexist there together, that is the perfection of human life. So this life is not perfect, which we are in this material world.
Obviously,
we will look same, think same there also. I mean, definitely our thoughts will be more pious and spiritual, but this human form is same in spiritual world also.
Yeah, form, that is a completely different.
We exist as you.
Satchitananda Vigraha. Yeah, we exist as individuals and we render service to the Lord. And like that, now our body is made of Asat, Achit and Nirananda. No? And the composition of, no, the from Asat, Achit and Nirananda, we can actually derive all these material elements. No? Earth, water, fire, air, ether, mind, intelligence, false ego. And then three modes of nature. All these things are coming from Asat, Achit and Nirananda. And the spiritual world, there are different kinds of ingredients. We have a spiritual body as well. And when this material body is destroyed, we will develop that spiritual body. So with this, which is Chinmaya body, which is like, no, with this like, no, Sat, Chit and no Ananda. So that will be the composition, the basic ingredients of the composition of the body that we will have in the spiritual world. So the material body is designed for sense gratification and the spiritual body is designed for service to the Lord. So here we are struggling to do service to the Lord. No, our senses keep us pulling to sense gratification. But when we have the spiritual body, no, even if we want to do sense gratification, it will be difficult. No, we will be like naturally inclined to the service of the Lord. All the apparatus that is given to us will be very apt to render service to the Lord.
Okay, and but we would exist, look, I mean, look and behave like humans only, but the composition will be entirely different as explained just now.
Yeah, the soul's evolved consciousness of the soul is human form, right? So in the material world, the evolved consciousness is human form. And if we can even evolve a little bit more, then that is the residence of spiritual world.
Okay. Yes. Then in paragraph 33 and 34, we have the Acharya ji says that, does it mean that living entity is eternal? Sanatana means that which has neither beginning nor end. So basically, so does it mean that living entity's eternal occupation to serve the Lord is continuous? Means like even in the material world and in the spiritual world, right? Or yeah. For all lives to come.
Yeah, be it all lives or if we put an end to all the birth, death cycle and go back to the spiritual world, whatever it is, our eternal occupation is to render service to the Lord. And that's why a devotee prays, you take me back to Godhead. Take me back to Vaikuntha or you keep me here, but just engage me in your service. So once we are engaged in our eternal occupation, Sanatana Dharma, automatically we become happy. So then it is no difference whether we live in the spiritual world or material world. So we are already come to the spiritual plane, then the location doesn't matter.
Okay.
So internally we have started living in spiritual world. If we have purified our consciousness, and after that, the material world is also like spiritual world. So there is one nice sloka is there. It says, I think sometimes we have discussed here also. So it says that Kaivalyam Narakayate. Kaivalyam means to merge in the existence of Brahman. So that is like Narakayate for a devotee, because like if he merges in the Brahma Jyoti, so where is the Lord? Where is he? The identity is lost and he cannot render service to the Lord. And then Kaivalyam Narakayate, Tridashapur Akasha Pushpayate. So going to the heavenly planets or going to different planets of demigods and enjoying higher material opulence. Oh, that is like Akasha Pushpa. Akasha Pushpa means it is like kind of an illusion. We get Pushpa in the tree, not in the Akasha. So Akasha Pushpa means it's just an illusion. No, temporarily I may get to some heavenly planet and enjoy for some time. But again, I have to give up that. No, again, I have to quit and I have to go to lower species or higher species. So, Tridashapur Akasha Pushpayate, Durdanthendriya Kala Sarpapatale. So, this senses are like venomous snake, no Durdanta. So, like they have venomous teeth in that. So, Kala Sarpa. So, this each and every one of our senses can actually drag us to sinful activities and it can actually take us on a wrong path. So, Durdanthendriya Kala Sarpapatale, Protkata Damstrayate. So by doing devotional service, what happens is, it is this protkata means like to extract this venomous teeth. No, protkata damstrayate. Damstra means like again teeth. So by doing devotional service, though we are having these senses which are very, very dangerous, like kala sarpa, but then their venomous teeth is plucked out. Protkata damstrayate. And then like what is it? Durdantendriya kala sarpa patale prokhata damstrayate vidhi bahendra adishta kitayate. So even the position of Indra or any powerful position, be a president or be any powerful position of this world, it looks like kita. Kita means like a small insect. No, we don't have any value for the material positions. So a person becomes completely indifferent to the material, like status or position and things like that. So anyway, it doesn't matter. It's like a foolish society. In the foolish society, if I'm not respected, if I'm not given any position, that's perfectly okay. Like, no, I don't want to be one of these fools. So vidhi mahendradishta kitayate, so vishvam purna sukayate, no? So like all this, the whole world appears to be like vishvam purna sukayate. How is it possible? This world is described as dukkalayam ashashvatam, no, temporary and full of miseries. And how does it become vishvam purna sukayate? So it is because yad vaibhavavatam, what is that? One who gets the merciful glance of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So then for that person, these kind of effects comes actually. No, he doesn't have any value for anything material or even the liberation where he has to merge in the existence of the Lord. He is only focused on how to render service to the Lord, and he is deriving so much of pleasure rendering service to the Lord. He just doesn't want to exchange it for anything else in the whole creation, right? So that's how this thing is. So in Sanatana Dharma, our business of rendering service to the Lord is continuous. No, be it life after life in this life, or in this world, or no, transfer to the spiritual world. No, once we transfer to the spiritual world, there is no more birth and death. So it goes to the level by saying that moksha laguta krit. This is one of the symptoms of devotional service. Moksha laguta krit means even the moksha, even the liberation appears to be very small in comparison to the devotional service. So a devotee says that mama janmani janmanishvare no bhavatad bhaktir ahituki tvai. So even if I have to take birth after birth, no, I'm not even aspiring for stopping the birth and death. Even if I have to take birth after birth in this world, no, I just simply hanker for your service, my Lord. And if that is there, I'm completely perfect. I'm completely okay. No, I don't want anything else. So it's essentially speaking that I'm transferred to the spiritual world. So maybe I'm existing in this material world, but in the consciousness level, in the deeper level, I am already there in the spiritual world. So if I'm posted in the spiritual world, it's okay. If I'm posted in the material world, it's okay. No, at the consciousness level, I've started living in the spiritual world. So it doesn't matter physically where I am. So that's how it becomes to.
Can I continue? Because I have few more doubts.
Okay. So then we will put the doubts towards the end. I think today we should be able to finish this. Right? So we will continue now the session. Okay.
Yeah. Now, thank you.
Start with this paragraph. How is this possible? The Acharya gives the following example. So what is this? How is this possible? To transfer our consciousness to the spiritual consciousness. So that's this one. And we will just read the last one line of this last paragraph. Therefore, we have to practice remembering the Lord 24 hours a day by chanting his names and molding our life's activities in such a way that we can remember him always. How is this possible? The Acharyas give the following example. If a married woman is attracted to another man, or if a man is attached for a woman other than his wife, then the attachment is to be considered very strong, because it is going beyond the social ties. If they have such attraction, so then it is going beyond the social ties. So it must be like very, very strong attachment. That's why he or she is like thinking in that way, right? So one with such an attachment is always thinking of the loved one. The wife who is thinking of her lover is always thinking of meeting him even while she is carrying out her household chores. In fact, she carries out her household work even more carefully so her husband will not suspect her attachment. Similarly, we should always remember the supreme lover, Sri Krishna, and at the same time perform our material duties very nicely. A strong sense of love is required here. If we have a strong sense of love for the Supreme Lord, then we can discharge our duty and at the same time remember him. But we have to develop the sense of love. No, that's the primary thing, no, love of God and Krishna prema. So that's our goal, no, to become a lover of God, right? Arjuna, for instance, was always thinking of Krishna. He was constant companion of Krishna. And at the same time, he was a warrior. Krishna did not advise him to give up fighting and go to the forest to meditate. When Lord Krishna delineates the yoga system to Arjuna, Arjuna says the best practice of this, says that the practice of this system is not possible for him. No, Arjuna vacha, yo yam yoga tvaya prokta, whatever yoga process that you have taught me, no, tvaya prokta, samyena madhusudana, etasyaham na pasyami, chanchalatvat stitam stiram. Right? So he is mentioning that Arjuna said, O Madhusudana, the system of yoga which you have summarized appears impractical and undurable to me, for the mind is restless and unsteady. So, no, this is sixth chapter is Dhyana Yoga. So Krishna mentions that you should go to the forest and you should sit down in such and such posture, and then no, you should like, no, so many rules and regulations. No, when we go to the Dhyana Yoga chapter, we will see. And at the end of Dhyana Yoga chapter, Arjuna is telling, oh, this thing no, appears to be so impractical. I'll not be able to do it. Right? So my mind is so restless and unsteady. It's not possible. So then the Lord says, no, yoginam api sarvesham madgathena antaratmana, antaratmana shraddhavan bhajate yomam same yukta tamo mataha. Of all yogis, the one with great faith who always abides in me, thinks of me within himself and renders transcendental loving service to me is the most intimately united with me in yoga and is the highest of all. That is my opinion. So that was Krishna, that was Arjuna was already like that. No, he was always rendering service to Krishna. He was attached to Krishna. So Krishna is telling, it doesn't require that you have to sit down in some place and you know, do some dhyana. If you are always connected with me in service, no, if always you are rendering some service to me, and somebody may ask, like, Krishna is not there now, how will I render service? No, we have to render service to the bona fide representatives of Krishna, like where the spiritual master or the Vaishnavas in general. So we should render service to them, and that is considered to be service to Krishna. And if we are constantly engaged in some service like that, then that is our connection to Krishna, right? And then by chanting also, by chanting and reading, that is like one kind of service. And other service is like practical services by cleaning the temple, or no, we do so a lot of programs here, and then no, helping people get connected to the programs in no, Krishna consciousness, and no, so many different things no, we can actually do. So this is the practical way of getting connected to the Lord. So Arjuna was also telling that, no, just leave me alone, Krishna, like I just want to go to the forest and meditate on you. Krishna told, no, I want you to fight for me. And you know, so one time this one this like one devotee was telling, in the Vrindavan, so temple, Krishna Balaram temple, our ISKCON temple was getting built, and this devotee was put in charge of the construction, and so many cement bags were coming and so much of material was coming, and he has to keep count of all of them, he has to deal with the laborers and things like that. And he went to Prabhupada and told, Prabhupada, I'm not able to focus on chanting. I'm not able to do anything. No, I'm just fully all the time thinking about the cement bags and this labors and things like that. And Prabhupada told, that's so nice. You are thinking about Krishna's service. Do you think Arjuna was thinking about no, meditating on the Lord? So he was actually seeing how to kill this guy, you know, how to kill this person. And he was aiming at people with arrows. And that's the service. That's what Krishna is asking Arjuna to do over here. And that's how, no, that's the topmost yogi. Like, no, Krishna is telling, no, somebody who's engaged in my transcendental loving service, no, Lord's service could be anything, whatever the Lord wishes. And if somebody is engaged in that way in the service of the Lord, oh, he is connected to me. No, he is connected to me. So one time, the devotees were doing book distribution. They were asking Prabhupada that, you see, like, no, most of the time we are, like taking the inventory of books, and then we are going to different places and we are distributing them and things like that. So most of the time we are just thinking that how to distribute this Bhagavad Gita to as many people as possible. And sometimes a lot of logistics is involved, and then we are not able to think of Krishna all the time. So if we die in between, what will happen? Ante Narayana Smriti, like no, that may not happen. We may be thinking about some logistics of transporting this, you know, Bhagavad Gita and things like that. So then Prabhupada told, so you people are so nicely engaged in Krishna's service. Even if you don't remember, Krishna will forcibly enter into your consciousness. So that's the opulence of doing devotional service to the Lord. No, anything that is connected to the Lord, so anything that has been asked of for the Lord's service. So when we are doing that bona fide service, so Krishna becomes very, very pleased. He will forcibly enter into the consciousness. He will actually become very pleased with that devotee. He struggled so much for my service. So he will very, very favorably disposed to such a devotee, right? So let's see, further. So one who thinks of the Supreme Lord always is the greatest yogi, the supermost jnani, and the greatest devotee at the same time, right? So how he is a yogi? Yogi means is one whose consciousness is fully fixed on the Lord. And here, this devotee is fully fixed on the service of the Lord. The service of the Lord, the name of the Lord, the descriptions of the Lord are not different from the Lord, right? So he's automatically a nice yogi. And then what is the position of a jnani? Jnani means one who knows that I am not this body, I am the soul, and I am spirit. I don't have anything to do with matter. So what else after that? If I am the spirit, what is my duty? My duty is to be engaged in the service of the eternal spirit, or the supermost spirit, the Paramatma, or the Supreme Lord. So then what is the devotee doing? Devotee is engaged in the service of the Lord. So he is the supermost jnani. Already he's engaged on the topmost level. And at the same time, he's a devotee also, right? So a devotee automatically fulfills the criteria for the greatest yogi and the supermost jnani, right? So simultaneously, it just happens. So the Lord further tells Arjuna that as a Kshatriya, he cannot give up his fighting. But if Arjuna fights remembering Krishna, so we know that sloka we read, Tasmat Sarveshu Kaleshu, Maam Arasmara Yuddhacha, right? So, if he'll be able to remember Krishna at the time, he cannot give up his fighting, but if Arjuna fights remembering Krishna, then he will be able to remember Krishna at the time of death. But one must be completely surrendered in the transcendental loving service of the Lord. So this is the key thing, actually. One should be surrendered in the service of the Lord, right? We work not with our body, actually, but with our mind and intelligence. So if the intelligence and mind are always engaged in the thoughts of Supreme Lord, then naturally the senses are also engaged in his service. Superficially, at least, the activities of the senses remain the same, but the consciousness is changed. So how is that superficially the activities remain the same? So after we becoming a devotee of the Lord, did we stop eating? Did we stop sleeping? Did we stop doing anything that we were doing before? No, it is only the consciousness that changes. No, it is only that we are Krishna conscious in doing all the activities. And we have just got a different orientation for doing all the activities. So same cooking. Before we were thinking what will give me pleasure? And now we are thinking what will give pleasure to Krishna. Oh, Krishna will like this thing. No, I will make nice preparation, right? So if we make nice preparation for the Lord, then obviously we will also get as prasad, very nice preparation, right? So in this way, the consciousness has changed. The external activities have not changed, right? So let's continue. The Bhagavad Gita teaches on how to absorb the mind and intelligence in the thought of the Lord. Such absorption will enable one to transfer himself to the kingdom of the Lord. If the mind is engaged in Krishna's service, then the senses are automatically engaged in the service. This is the art, and this is also the secret of Bhagavad Gita. Total absorption in thought of Krishna. An amazing point Prabhupada is writing, right? If the mind is engaged in Krishna's service, then the senses are automatically engaged in the service. This is the art, and this is also the secret of Bhagavad Gita. Total absorption in the thought of Sri Krishna, right? So this is this is the amazing gift of Bhagavad Gita, right? So modern man has struggled very hard to reach the moon, but he has not tried very hard to elevate himself spiritually. If one has 50 years of life ahead of him, he should engage that brief time in cultivating this practice of remembering the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Now, this is a very nice statement Prabhupada is making. If one has 50 years of life ahead of him, one should engage that brief time. Now, by using this nice, I don't know what do you call this adjective or the description. So brief time. Even if we have 50 years, it is just brief time. Even if you have 100 years ahead of you, it's just a brief time. No, in the purview of eternal existence of our life, no, we have been, no, always been existing. No, since time immemorial, we have been existing. No, our soul, like, no, we as a soul, we have been existing. In that, this 50 years is nothing, actually. So if we can actually give this, no, alpa time, no, it's like very, very small time. If we can actually give this small time in service of Krishna, so we will get, no, eternal benefit. Henceforward, we will always be happy, right? So that's the amazing aspect, actually. And so this practice is devotional process. And what is this devotional process? No, Prabhupada is quoting from, no, Prahlad Maharaj's statements from 7th canto of Bhagavatam. Shravanam kirtanam Vishnoho, smaranam padasevanam, archanam vandanam dasyam, sakyam atmanivedanam. Right? These nine processes, of which the easiest is shravanam, no, hearing the Bhagavad Gita from the realized person, will turn one to the thought of Supreme Being. This will lead to remembering the Supreme Lord and will enable one upon leaving the body to attain a spiritual body which is just fit for association with the Supreme Lord. Right? The Lord further says, Abhyasa yoga yuktena chetasa nanya gamina paramam purusham divyam yati parthanu chintayan. So he who meditates on me, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, his mind constantly engaged in remembering me, undeviated from the path, he, O Arjuna, is sure to reach me. Right? So it's like abhyasa yoga. No, we have to make it a practice. So devotional practice. We don't have natural attraction for these practices. So no, we need to have a prescribed number of rounds. No, mercifully, the acharyas have given us that, no, we should chant 16 rounds of Hare Krishna mantra every day. And then, this is also a very important point. If we want to understand spiritual literature, then it's very important to follow the acharya. It's very important to chant the 16 rounds of Hare Krishna mantra and then studying the scriptures and things like that in a nice way. So by doing this, we will get some clarity of thought to penetrate into the deeper aspects of the scripture. Otherwise, if we are not so nice in the Abhyasa Yoga, which is mentioned here, so if you are not very good in our Abhyasa, so then we will only get the surface. No, we will not be able to enter into the deepest cores of the Bhagavad Gita. So deepest meaning of the Bhagavad Gita. We will only be getting some surface level. This one, like if you see in terms of fishing in the ocean, fishing or marine expedition. So if in the surface, all small fishes and small, puny things, no, people will get. But then if they know how to dive deep, they will get pearls. They will get so many wonderful gems that are there in the depth of the ocean. So in the same way, Bhagavad Gita can be compared like an ocean. And if our abhyasa, if our practice is very nice, if we are culturing our practice based on the instructions of the acharya, so then we will have, explore gems. We will explore so many wonderful things of this great literature. Right? So, abhyasa yoga yuktena chetasa nanya gamina paramam purusham divyam yati partha anuchintayan. No? Anuchintayan means like always, constant. Anu means constant. Or fall. One of the meanings of the word anu is constant. Another meaning is that to follow in the footsteps of the great acharyas. So it is not that, no, I will take Bhagavad Gita and I will understand the way I want. I will master it. No, Bhagavad Gita is non-different from Krishna. We cannot master Krishna just like that. We can only beg Krishna, and Krishna has to reveal himself to us. Right? So that's the way. No, we should always remember this. It is not that, no, I have Bhagavad Gita book in my hand. I will master this book. No, it is not possible. Krishna will throw bouncers at us. We will be completely, no, bowled over. We will not be able to even understand head or tail of Bhagavad Gita. We have to follow in the footsteps of great acharyas, right? So there is this nice sloka that is there, which is mentioned. Tarka apratishta. By tarka vada vivad, we cannot establish what is dharma. No, we cannot understand scriptures. Tarka apratishta shrutayo vibhinna. Even the scriptures talk in different way. Shrutayo vibhinna. Nasa munir yasya matirna vinnam. So great thinkers and great people like who are studying the scriptures and on their own strength. No, they are called as muni. They are not devotees, they are munis. So nasa munir yasya matirna bhinnam. So every muni has his own mat, no, his own understanding. No, nasa munir yasya matirna bhinnam. Dharmasya tattvam nihitam guhayam. The secret, no, this dharma is a very, very secret thing. Dharmasya tattvam nihitam guhayam. Very, very, no secret actually. And then mahajano yena katasya panta. One who follows in the footsteps of great acharyas, they will be able to unlock this. Other people, no, let them do tarka, no, tarko apratishta, shrutayo vibhinna. No, munis, like great thinkers, no, they can also do anything in terms of understanding the secrets of dharma. Only, no, we have to, by following in the footsteps of great acharyas, we will be able to understand this. So we have, no, like the great fortune of studying Srila Prabhupada's purports, no, who's a great acharya, and himself, he himself also like cited from other great acharyas like Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur and Baldev Vidyabhushan and Jiva Goswami and many other great acharyas in the past. So he has very, very chastely, no, we should use this word chastity. So he has very chastely presented the paramparas, no, this one. He has not introduced anything new for himself also. Now this is the greatness of an acharya. He doesn't introduce anything new. In fact, in the introduction beginning or preface, we studied this thing that Prabhupada says that, no, my only credit is I have presented Bhagavad Gita as it is. I have not introduced any of my concoction, right? So even while studying this introduction also, we were able to map each and every line for some sloka in the Bhagavatam or Bhagavad Gita. So that is the chastity of Srila Prabhupada. So he never deviated from even an inch from the scriptures, and that's the glorious aspect. And as you people will become more and more learned in the scriptures, you will see when you read Prabhupada's purports, you will see, no, this is from this sloka of Bhagavatam, or this is from this sloka of the Vedic literatures. So everything is directly from the Vedic literatures, and he is giving the digest of the entire Vedic literatures in such easily consumable, no, English language. Right, so that's the greatness of the acharya. So we should be very, very grateful to Srila Prabhupada for this presentation. If not for this, no, we can just keep scratching Bhagavad Gita. Nothing we will understand. Right, so it's we should be eternally grateful to Srila Prabhupada for this thing. Right, so in the Guru Puja, we actually sing one prayer for Srila Prabhupada. So it says Chakshudan Dilo Jay Janma Janma Prabhu Se. It's a Bengali prayer. So it says that Chakshudan Dilo Jay. So one who has given us the eyes, no, the scriptures are the eyes. So no, Srila Prabhupada has very mercifully given us the eyes to see the scriptures, right? So the eyes to see the world through the eyes of scriptures. And no, if we are left alone to study all the Vedic literatures and bring about the conclusion and to map that to Bhagavad Gita, forget it. We will not be able to do it in one lifetime. So that's how much is the contribution of Srila Prabhupada. So we should be always grateful to him, right? Okay, let's continue. This is not a very difficult process. However, one must learn it from an experienced person. Tat vijnanartham sa gurumeva abhigachet. No, one must approach a person who is already in practice. Already in the practice. The mind is always flying to this and that. But one must practice concentrating the mind always on the form of Supreme Lord Sri Krishna or on the sound of his name. Right. So this, like the Lord and his name are not different. No, abhinnatvam nama naminah. So the mind is naturally restless, going hither and thither, but it can rest in the sound vibration of Krishna. One must thus meditate on a paramam purusham, the supreme personality of Godhead in the spiritual kingdom, the spiritual sky, and thus attain him. The ways and the means for ultimate realization, ultimate attainment are stated in Bhagavad Gita, and the doors of this knowledge are open for everyone. No one is barred out. All classes of men can approach Lord Krishna by thinking of him, for hearing and thinking of him are possible for everyone. The Lord further says in 9:32 and 33, Mam hi partha shu papa yonaya striyo vaishyas tata shudras thepi yanti param gatim kim punar brahmana punya bhaktya bhakta raja vishayas tata anityam asukam lokam imam prapya bhajasva mam. Thus the Lord says that even a member, even a merchant, a fallen woman or a laborer, or even human beings in the lower status of life can attain the Supreme. So in the Vedic process, if we see, no, anyone apart from Brahmana, no, they don't have the access to the scriptures and they cannot practice anything higher. And then women thought like they cannot even think of doing any spiritual practice in the Vedic ritualistic system. So, but then the devotional service to the Lord, Bhakti Yoga, there is no bar for anyone, no? Be it women, be it a Shudra, be it anyone for that matter, everyone can progress. Everyone has equal opportunity in this particular discipline. So that's the beauty of the devotional service of the Lord. So that's why, you know, this thing is quoted here. One does not need highly developed intelligence. The point is that anyone who accepts the principle of Bhakti Yoga and accepts the Supreme Lord as the summum bonum of life, as the highest target, the ultimate goal, can approach the Lord in the spiritual sky. If one adopts the principle enunciated in Bhagavad Gita, he can make his life perfect and make a permanent solution to all problems of life. This is the sum and substance of the entire Bhagavad Gita. Right? So it's a very clear this one. So we will read the next paragraph. In conclusion, Bhagavad Gita is a transcendental literature which one should read very carefully. Gita Shastram Idam Punyam Yor Patet Prayatap Puman. So this is from Gita Mahatmaya, right? So this is Gita Mahatmaya's first sloka. Gita Shastram Idam Punyam Yor Patet Prayatap Puman. If one properly follows the instructions of Bhagavad Gita, one can be freed from all miseries and anxieties of life. No, Bhaya Shokati Varjitaha. No, one will be like freed from Bhaya and Shoka, right? So Bhaya Shokati Varjitaha. And one will be freed from all fears in this life, and one's next life will be spiritual, right? So this is Gita Mahatmaya first. So this Gita Mahatmaya is it's a very nice set of slokas, which is now giving the glories of Bhagavad Gita, right? So let's just read them. It's very nice to go through these things. There is also a further advantage. Gita dhyana shilasya pranayama parasya cha naiva santhi hi papani purva janma kritani cha. If one reads Bhagavad Gita very sincerely with all seriousness, then by the grace of the Lord, the reactions of his past misdeeds will not act upon him, right? So all karma stops, you know, if somebody reads Bhagavad Gita seriously, right? The Lord says very loudly in the last portion of Bhagavad Gita, Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraja, aham tvam sarva papebhyo moksha ishyami masuchah. Abandon all varieties of religion and just surrender unto me. I shall deliver you from all sinful reactions. Do not fear. Thus the Lord takes all responsibility for one who surrenders unto him, and he indemnifies such a person against all reactions of sins. Right? So, like the study of Gita can destroy all the sins. Then next Mahatmaya is Mala Nirmochanam Pumsam Jalasnanam Dine Dine Sakrit Gita Amrita Snanam Samsara Malanasanam. Right? So one may cleanse himself daily by taking a bath in water, but if one takes a bath even once in the sacred Ganges water of Bhagavad Gita, for him, the dirt of material life is altogether vanquished. Right? Very amazing, very, very poetic, this one. It is compared to taking bath. Right? So in the day, if we are not studying Gita or Bhagavatam, we should consider that, you know, we are like a Shudra. You know, we have not taken bath on that day. So we have to take bath every day by studying Gita and Bhagavatam. Gita su Gita kartavya kim anya shastra vistaraihi ya svayam padmanabhasya Mukha Patmat Vinishrita. So this is a very nice comparison, no? Like this Ganga water is coming from the lotus feet of the Lord, right? So when Lord Vamanadev, when he extended his feet and he measured the whole universe, he created a crack in the universal shell, and the Karana ocean or the Viraja, water from the Karana ocean actually came inside, and then it washed the feet of the Lord. And it entered into this one. So Lord Brahma catches hold of that. And then later Lord Shiva holds in his head. And then finally Bhagirath Maharaj brings it to the earthly planet. And in this way the Ganga comes. And Ganga is considered to be purifying. Right? So because it has no, touch the lotus feet of the Lord. It is like a river of Charanamrit. No, that's the Ganga. So it can purify. So, but then to have take bath in Ganga, you have to go a very long distance. But then if the water that has touched the lotus feet of the Lord is so purifying. So this Gita has come from the lotus mouth of the Lord. No, Mukha Padma. So it is come from the lotus mouth of the Lord. So this is also purifying. This is amazingly purifying. And this is there everywhere. You don't need to travel anywhere. You can actually get access to Lord's Charanamrit or Lord's mercy in the form of Bhagavad Gita from anywhere and everywhere, right? Okay. Because Bhagavad Gita is spoken by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, one need not read any other Vedic literature. One need only attentively and regularly hear and read Bhagavad Gita. In the present age, people are so absorbed in mundane activities that it is not possible for them to read all the Vedic literatures. But this is not necessary. This one book, Bhagavad Gita, will suffice because it is the essence of all Vedic literatures, and especially because it is spoken by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, right? So, okay, so this is the meaning. So I was just getting the meaning of the next sloka here. Anyways, so, Bharatamrita Sarvasvam Vishnu Vaktrad Vinirshitam Gita Gangodakam Pitva Punar Janmana Vidyate. One who drinks the water of Ganges attains salvation. So what to speak of one who drinks the nectar of Bhagavad Gita? Like Bhagavad Gita is the essence of Mahabharata and it is spoken by Lord Krishna himself, the original Vishnu. Okay. So Bhagavad Gita comes from the mouth of Supreme Personality of Godhead and the Ganges is said to emanate from the lotus feet of the Lord. Of course, there is no difference between the mouth and the feet of the Supreme Lord. But from an impartial study, we can appreciate that Bhagavad Gita is even more important than the water of Ganges. Okay. Sarva Upanishado Gavo Dhokta Gopala Nandanaha Partho Vatsaha Sudhir Bhokta Dugdham Githamritam Mahat. This Gita Upanishad, Bhagavad Gita, the essence of all the Upanishads, is just like a cow. And Lord Krishna, who is famous as the cowherd boy, is milking the cow. Arjuna is just like a calf. And learned scholars and pure devotees are to drink the nectarian milk of Bhagavad Gita. Very, very poetic comparison, right? So, all of you who have seen milking of the cow, in our temple we have cows. So, if we have to milk the cow, we have to get the calf near to the cow. Without the cow will not give milk. So in the same way, like we see that all the Vedic literatures and Upanishads, everything is considered to be put together. Summation is Bhagavad Gita and this is the cow and Lord Krishna is milking the cow and the calf is Arjuna. He is the first person who drinks the milk and the milk is available for all of us. All the pure devotees and all the scholars and everyone, they can drink the nectarian milk of Bhagavad Gita, right? So, Ekam Shastram Devaki Putra Gitam Eko Devo Devaki Putra Eva Eko Mantras Tasya Nama Niyani Karmapi Ekam Tasya Devasya Seva. So in the, like, this is like Ekam Shastram. So let there be one scripture, that is Devaki Putra Gitam. So that is like Krishna's Gita, Bhagavad Gita. And Eko Deva Devaki Putra Eva, let there be one God, that is Krishna. And Eko Mantras Tasya Nama Niyani, let there be one mantra. So that is his name, that is his holy name, the Hare Krishna mantra, right? So karma api ekam, tasya devasya seva. Let there be one karma, let there be one work. So what is that? Tasya devasya seva. Let there be one work, that is the service to the Supreme Lord, right? So in the present day, people are very much eager to have one scripture, one God, one religion and one occupation. Therefore, ekam shastram devaki putra gitam. Let there be one scripture only, one common scripture for the whole world, Bhagavad Gita. Eko Deva Devaki Putra Eva, let there be one God for the whole world, Sri Krishna. Eko Mantras Tasya Namani. So, and one hymn, one mantra, one prayer, the chanting of his name, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Karma Api Ekam Tasya Devasya Seva. And let there be one work only, the service of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, right? So this is the end of the introduction. So very, very amazing way this is presented. And this is another very glorious thing. No, Prabhupada is establishing how he is authorized to comment upon this Bhagavad Gita. He is authorized to write in about the Bhagavad Gita. So this is the disciplic succession that he is presenting. So evam parampara praptam imam raja rishiyo viduhu. No, Bhagavad Gita 4.2. It says this Bhagavad Gita as it is received through this disciplic succession. Krishna, he spoke to Brahma, and Brahma spoke to Narada, Narada to Vyasa, and from there Madhva, Padmanabha, Narahari, Madhava, Akshobhya, Jayatirtha, Jnana Sindhu, Dayanidhi, Vidyanidhi, Rajendra, and Jayadharma, Purushottama, Brahmanya Tirtha, then Vyasa Tirtha, Lakshmipati, Madhavendra Puri, Ishwara Puri, Lord Chaitanya. So Ishwara Puri's contemporaries were Nityananda Prabhu and Advaita Acharya, whom we chant in the Panchatattva Mantra. And then Lord Chaitanya is in the next generation. So Lord Chaitanya and his disciples, Rupa Goswami and all the six Goswamis, and then Swarup Damodar Goswami and all these, you know, direct associates of Lord Chaitanya. And then we have Raghunath Das Goswami and Jiva Goswami. And then Krishna Das Kaviraj Goswami, then Narottam Das Thakur, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, whose commentaries Prabhupada of, you know, extensively quotes. And then Baldev Vidya Bhushan. So he is also, you know, like extensively quoted. In fact, no, Prabhupada actually takes most of the purports, you know, of this Bhagavad Gita as it is from Baldev Vidya Bhushan's commentaries. So Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur and Baldev Vidya Bhushan are very, very glorious commentators on both Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. So, and Srila Prabhupada very, very chastely presents their viewpoints in Bhagavad Gita. Right? So, not only just viewpoints, he has just presented their points and then given the contemporary understanding of how to apply those points. Right? So, Baldev Vidya Bhushan, then Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj. So, then Bhakti Vinod Thakur, Gaur Kishore Das Babaji, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati, and then no, he puts himself in the line. So that is A.C. Bhakti Vedanta Swami Prabhupada. So this is how this book has actually come down. So this knowledge has come down in the parampara. So we know our connection to Krishna. No, exactly, we know our connection to Krishna. So now we come to the end of introduction and the Guru Parampara list. So after this, we will be entering into first chapter. So now we will take up some questions, if there is any.
Yes, Prabhuji, can I go ahead?
Yeah.
This is from Para 34.
Okay.
There is this last line in Para 34, which says, it is possible for us to see that Sanatana Dharma is the business of all the people of the world, nay, of all the living entities of the universe. I didn't understand this, nay, all the living entities of the universe, and it is mentioned of all the people of the world. And does it link to paragraph 37 also, where we are talking about different religion, and but in all circumstances, the change of religious faith does not affect the eternal occupation of rendering service to others.
So it's like,
are both these paragraphs linked?
See, Sanatan Dharma is the business of all people of the world, and not just people means not just human beings, all the living entities. Name means not only that, no, it is also the business of all the living entities. In fact, when I was mentioning that point, I was telling, so be it bacteria or virus or no, whatever germs or whatever it is, all of them are living entities. So they can potentially become human beings. They can potentially get back to the spiritual world. They are same as us. Like, no, we are soul and they are soul. They have a small body and we have a big body. That's all is the difference. But all of them are living entities. All of them are children of God. And all of their business is to render loving devotional service to God. Right? So in the human society, be it, no, they are of different religion, it's okay. And no, be it any of the forms, be it the form of a dog or a cat or a germ or a insect, whatever it may be, like, no, everybody's business is to render service to Krishna.
So can they think like us, like they have to think about God? I mean,
so we can engage them in Krishna service by offering prasadam, So, like, there are many cases where devotees offered prasadam to other living entities and they got liberated also. So, there is scripture.
But there are so many in this world.
Yeah, we can actually pray for them.
There are so many.
In fact, this question Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asked that Haridas Thakur, like one of the greatest devotees, you know, he says that, my dear Haridas, how will all the people of this world be liberated? How will all the living entities be liberated? How will the non-moving living entities be liberated? So then Haridas Thakur says, when a devotee loudly chants the Hare Krishna mantra, and when it is reverberates, you know, when the trees and the like non-moving entities reverberates, so they are actually taking part in the kirtan. So all the living entities, many times, like Prabhupada has did this, if some animal is dying or some insect is there or something like that, so sometimes he used to ask his disciples, okay, you just sit down here and chant for this no living entity, right? So you know, it is like it's like every living entity has the opportunity to go get back to the spiritual world. If they cannot do, we can assist them, you know? So we can assist them in the process.
And para 37 is this what you explained, that irrespective of religion, community, country, the prime duty is to serve the Lord, and we all belong to one Lord.
Yeah. So that's a problem.
Whether we are from Sri Lanka, whether we are, yeah. So irrespective of the country, I am saying.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Any country, any this one. That's why Srila Prabhupada preached all over the world, and he, you know, people accepted him, and he had disciples from all over the world. And like we see that these kind of faiths, sometimes Prabhupada used to see if somebody is practicing any other religion very seriously and then he is advancing, he used to appreciate them. He used to appreciate them saying that dharma svanishtuta pumsha vishvakshena katashuya no thadaye dedhiratim shramayevahi kevalam. So that means if you are following any dharma, you know, and then if you are not getting like rati or attraction towards the Supreme Lord, so then it is mentioned as shrama evahi kevalam. You have only labored hard and no, there is no effect of it or no benefit of it. So if by following Christian religion or Islam religion, if somebody is becoming a lover of God, so then that's very nice. No, that's the perfection of religion. You're following something very nice. So in the same way, like the whole purpose of religion is to become a lover of God, right? So that should be the primary thing. Not that I belong to this religion, I belong to that religion. And we know that, you know, Vedic scriptures is the one which gives elaborate information about this particular thing, you know, about how to develop this love and affection towards the Lord. So otherwise, most of the religions of the world consider the Lord to be a controller or a master, or at max Paramatma realization they may take up to. The Bhagavan realization is very difficult in other religions.
So it should be also reflected in our behavior, because many people, they seem to pray a lot and perform various rituals. But it's a personal experience, but their behavior or their attitude, even their facial expression, doesn't reflect any warmth. So anybody who prays to the Lord sincerely, whether he's from any religion, I think it should internally and externally, I mean, it should reflect that person's thoughts.
Yeah, yeah. Once they
I don't know. I mean, yeah, in temples also.
Yeah, yeah. See, all kinds of people will be there. So,
like in temples also.
Temples, basically, if you see, even in ISKCON temples also, you cannot expect everyone to be like, you know, very well behaved. You know, because somebody may be just new and he may not have that level of realization. So, temples are like hospitals. And somebody may be like just admitted in the hospital, and somebody may be in the process of recovery, and somebody is like just awaiting his discharge, you know. So different kinds of people will be there. So all the people of this world are diseased. And somebody who comes to the temple and practices, he has just accepted the treatment. So we cannot expect him to be completely free from the material disease of lust, anger, greed, envy, pride, and things like that. So it is only an advanced person will be freed from all these things.
And in paragraph 42, it is said that he descended in his original form as he is. So basically, Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and he had taken various avatars, the common ones which we know. but this avatar was his original form, which we see and preach. Like,
yeah.
But people think that this is only avatar. Like, people who don't believe that Krishna is the supreme personality of Godhead, they think that he was one of the avatars of God.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's basically that he's the original person and he descended as he is on the earth in that avatar.
Yeah, yeah. That's correct.
And this is my last question. Krishna Loka and Goloka are same?
So Krishna So Krishna loves cows so much. So his planet is named after cows, Goloka.
Okay. Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna. Yeah.
Anyone else has any questions? They can ask or we can wind up. Okay. Thank you very much.
Hello, Prabhuji.
Okay, Srikant Prabhu. Yes, Prabhu.
Yeah, like you have told, like it is a disciplinic succession from Brahma to Srila Prabhupada. Like the Krishna might have preached long back to Brahma, and from Brahma only I see only 32 generations or something like that.
Okay, that's a good question. It's a good question. So Krishna and like Krishna spoke to Brahma in the beginning of creation, and then if you see Krishna, Brahma, Narada and Vyasa, all these three are, even now Vyasadeva is living even now in Badrikashram. So we cannot reach to that area where Vyasadeva is there. He's an eternal personality. He's even now doing tapasya in the Badrikashram. So Madhvacharya, we all know, like most of you in Karnataka would have gone to Udupi.
Madhvacharya is from Tamil Nadu, right?
No, he's like in Karnataka only. Like we have this Pajaka Kshetra and places like that. No, Udupi and all area. So that's the region of Madhvacharya.
Okay.
This one. And he was, he actually went to this Badrikashram. And he met with Vyasadeva and he took initiation from Vyasa directly. So that's where the gap is covered. So Madhvacharya is a recent personality. And he met Vyasadeva. No, that's how the gap is covered. Otherwise, it's like Brahma, Narada and Vyasa is like very old. No, and Madhvacharya is the recent.
Ah, very old. That's
so that is how the gap is covered. So these
Vyasa
are...
Sage who used to stay when Mahabharata used to take place, right?
Yeah. Even Vyasa
Dev is
Vyasa
Chiranjeev.
Conceived Pandu, Dhritarashtra, Vidura, and all these personalities. So Vyasa is the the son father of them.
Okay.
Hari Hari. Hare Krishna.
Okay. Hare Krishna.
So, thanks a lot for putting these wonderful questions and making these sessions very interactive and very nice. So, I hope all of you understand Bhagavad Gita nicely and digest this scripture. So, this is our scripture, and we should have complete understanding of the scripture. So, that's how we can actually that's a great service to the humanity, actually, trying to understand Bhagavad Gita in real essence, real full. In full, right? So thank you for investing your time in this and trying to study this great scripture in detail. Thanks a lot. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.